Hello and welcome to Theology on Tap. I want to talk about a word today in scripture that is very significant. It is actually very significant, much more than most people think or believe it to be. And the word is Abba, Abba Father. It is mentioned only three times in the New Testament. The word Father is mentioned quite a bit, but Abba Father is only mentioned three times. The first time it is mentioned is in the book of Mark, chapter 14. When Jesus cries out to God, right? He said, Abba, Father, all things were possible unto you. Take away this cup from me. This is when Jesus is about to go and get crucified. And that's when Jesus calls God, Abba, Father. And the word Abba is kind of like a child calling out to, a beloved way of calling out to his own father, right? Abba, Father. When my kids were born, I had them call me Papa. You know, instead of daddy or father or anything like that. So they call me Papa, and it was a mistake, to be honest with you, because all day long they kept on saying Papa, 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 and I just kind of got tired of it. But at the same time, they don't call me Papa anymore, and I kind of miss it, you know? And I'm sure that God, as he was allowing the disciples and Paul and other people to write the New Testament, I'm sure this word was very important. It was a very beloved, intimate way a child would call out to his own father, Abba, Father. But there is a meaning behind Abba that I think all Christians have missed, all of them. It's not that I have a special revelation or anything, but since I am not confined to the traditional way of understanding the Bible, I have an open mind. I want to seek the truth, right? For only the truth will set you free. And if you have watched my other videos, you will know that the big thing, the major thing that I have a problem with Christian theology is that most Christians still focus their behaviors or their faith on themselves, right? It's more like, what can I do for God who was crucified for me? Whereas, and I don't think that's what the Bible is talking about. And there's nothing new or hidden messages in the Bible. It is the same message that is repeated over and over again, and that is Jesus and Him crucified. Everything is about Jesus Christ. And how does that make a difference in the way we live? I think it's huge. It is huge. And I made quite a few videos talking about how I have this bitterness towards Christian understanding of sin. And please watch my videos on that. Hopefully you will agree and change your perspective. We're no longer sinners. Now, second time in the word Abba is mentioned in his book of Romans chapter 8, third time in Galatians. But Galatians and Romans are talking about the same thing. So I'm gonna go over book of Romans chapter 8 with you when Paul tells us that we call God our Abba Father. Very significant, all right? No one's gonna tell you this except me, so please pay attention, all right, or get a drink so that you won't call me a heretic or anything like that. So here we go. All right, you know that book of Romans is about how Paul spends about four chapters, the very first four chapters talking about the law and how it doesn't work. Starting on chapter 5, we see that it is the faith of Christ, what He has done, that has brought the righteousness of God into our lives. And that's very important. So we got chapter 5, 6, and 7 is when Paul compares kind of a little bit about why, not compares, he explains on why we need to get rid of the law because it doesn't work, because he talked about it in chapter 1 through 4. Gotta get rid of it. It must become obsolete in order for us to have a relationship with God in another way, which is in the Spirit of God. And the word obsolete is there. It's written in the scripture, right? The law has to become obsolete so that the Spirit of God may resurrect. So we may have a new relationship with God through Jesus Christ and what He has done. Starting on chapter 8, in the middle of it, this is when Paul begins to tell us about the life in the Spirit of God. This is very exciting time. And if you haven't read Romans chapter 8, you should read that every single day because it is one of the most uplifting chapters in the Bible. So Paul talks about the Spirit in chapter 8, and the very first thing he says is this. Listen to this. It's in Romans chapter 8, verse 15 is one that I want to focus on. But before that, it says this: we are debtors. Okay, we have an obligation as Christians, right? And that obligation is not to the flesh to live according to the flesh, but because if you do, you shall die. But our obligation is to be led by the Spirit of God. Once again, if you read it in the context, living in the flesh is living by the law, because the law is of the flesh, right? You can't do this, you can't do that, or whatever, you can't drink, can't smoke, you can't, and all that kind of stuff. You know, gotta get rid of that, right? Because our obligation is not to the flesh and live according to the rules and the regulation of the flesh, but live by the Spirit of God. And the very first thing that the Spirit of God does for us is this. Verse 15, for you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. Because I really believe living your life by the law is bondage. Right? There are some, you know, believers of Jesus Christ that think that not eating potato chips or drinking Coca-Cola or drinking wine for a month or two or things like that is sacrificing for God. And I always say that's not true. You might be sacrificing for the church, which is fine, by the way. If you make that commitment to do away with snacks or any kind of junk food to make yourself healthy, perfectly fine. And if you want to do it for the church, perfectly fine. However, you got to be careful in saying, that's what I am doing this for God. Okay? You got to be honest about that. Anyways, verse 15. Because that's kind of like bondage, living in bondage, you gotta do it. But plus, when was the last time when you made a decision about, you know, living a life where you wanna be healthy and whatnot? When was the last time you actually followed through? Which is very interesting because I have this addiction to ice cream. It is terrible, actually. Cherry Garcia is my favorite. And when I worked in a construction for about a year and a half, I was a laborer for a construction company. And I lost a lot of pounds and whatnot. When I quit because I hurt my back, I don't know why, I needed to eat Cherry Garcia every day, right? And I'm still in there. I gained a lot of weight because of it. Anyway, see, that's bondage, if you will, all right? I promise God I'm not gonna eat it again, but I keep on eating Cherry Garcia, so I'm bringing curse to myself, right? You have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption. See, so if you're going to go ahead and say, you know, I call God my Abba Father, and the reason why we're able to do so is because we have been adopted into his family. We're no longer living by the law or by the flesh. We have been taken away from that, and we have been adopted to a new family that is by the Spirit of God, where we call God Abba Father, right? And what is interesting is that that's the first thing that Paul talks about, the difference between living by the law and living by the Spirit of God. If you're led by the Spirit of God, then you will know that you have been adopted. Why is that so important? Now, you could hear sermons about being adopted and whatnot, and which is kind of funny that my mother, my parents actually, used to make fun of me all the time when I was growing up in Korea, and they used to always say the same thing over and over again, you know, that I was found under a bridge, I was adopted and things like that. That's why I look different. I'm taller than anyone else, and I am less smart than my brothers, which is interesting. My parents used to call me stupid all the time. But I have the highest degree in our family, so figure that out. Anyway, but to be honest with you, I'm not that smart. There are some really smart Christians out there who study a lot, but I think being too smart is not good. That's what I think anyway. Going back to this, all right, we cry out to God, Abba Father. That is so significant. Why? Please pay attention. The reason why we call God Abba Father, it's not just because, you know, it is true that we have been adopted to his family, you know, so we have a new relationship with God. Those are all true, and the people would agree with that. A lot of Christians would agree with that. But within this new family too, as Christians, we were told the law, even in the new family. So I don't think this is about being adopted into God's family. It's not about, oh, you know, before we're sinners, but now, even though we still sin, we're a bunch of sinners, we're saved because we have a Father who loves us. And if we sin, He disciplines us, you know? Things like that. It is very human, but this theology of being adopted into God's family is freaking amazing. It really is. Because Book of John says the same thing too, right? John 3:16. And if you haven't seen my video on John 3:16, please do so. Born again. We're born again. And that's very important because we're adopted into God's family. Now, every one of us, right? Every human being is born of a woman. In Book of Genesis, you see that Adam and Eve were not born of a woman, right? They were not born of women. They were created by God. And they had a great relationship with God. And sin came in, and they got kicked out of the kingdom, God's Garden of Eden. And what was the first thing they noticed? First thing, that they were naked, right? They were naked. So they started, you know, hiding themselves and whatnot. Why is this significant is that we became aware of our body in a way that we became sexual beings. And after that, we started having children and whatnot. And Eve became the mother of us all, right? Born of a woman. And if you remember, in the Garden of Eden, everything was perfect. When they got kicked out and they found themselves attracted to one another, right, physically, and they started having sex and having children, think about it. Cain and Abel were born to them, and we know the story about Cain and Abel. Jealousy, right, came in to a point where Cain murders his own brother. That's terrible, and it's horrible. And that is something that we gotta understand, that we were all born of women. And if you really think about it, born of a woman, I mean, there's some great men that were born of women, definitely. Most people are good, definitely, but there's always, right, sin. In fact, King David says, after he commits adultery and, I guess, in a way, causes the woman's husband to die, right? So is that murder? Okay, but after he realizes of his sin, big sin, if you want to call that sin, he writes Psalm 51, where he admits that from the mother's womb, right? From the mother's womb, when he was born from his mother's womb, he was born into sin. And that is very interesting. That is something that we always teach one another, right? We're born sinners, we're told. Why? It's not because we've done anything wrong, right? Kids don't sin because they're selfish or anything like that. They just want to survive. But we're born into sin because we're born of a woman. Born of woman. We're born into sin. And that's very important to understand. So as Christians, we don't just go around saying, you know, everybody's a sinner, and everybody's a sinner, and everybody's a sinner, because there's this huge difference now. Big difference. That even though we're born of woman, right, we have been adopted, right, by the Spirit of God. Point where we can call God Abba Father. Terms of endearment. That's the difference. You know, Jesus says in the book of John, I believe, he says that, not book of John, Matthew somewhere. Let me look at this. Matthew 11, all right? It says, "Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there has not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he." Right? What a great news. There is not one person that is greater than John the Baptist that is born of women. But, right, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John the Baptist, who is the greatest of them all. Now, you could argue about why he's so great or whatever. That's not the point. The point is John the Baptist or any of Moses or anyone else you could think of that is born of women, you know, they could be awesome and great. However, those of us who are least in the kingdom of heaven, right, is greater than John the Baptist. Why? Why? Because when you are born of women, we're born into sin, that we try to do good, but we don't. But when the law came in for God to tell us what is right and wrong, we thought that we could follow the law once we know what to do. However, it didn't work. It is interesting that once in a while, when I tell people about the fact that we are not just forgiven of our sin, but the law has become obsolete, so therefore sin is obsolete. That we don't live by law and sin anymore, we follow the Spirit of God. And every time I say that, the very first question they ask me is, does that mean that I could do whatever I want? Does that mean that I could sin as much as I want? And my answer has always been the same. And maybe it's stupid for me to say it, but I said, do whatever you want. Do whatever you want. In fact, just recently somebody asked me that as a married person, you think it's okay to commit adultery? You know? And we talked about that a little bit. And the final thing is, hey, do whatever you want. You want to commit adultery? Go ahead and do it. Right? I mean, that's what Christians say anyways, right? God forgives you of your sins and whatnot. Go ahead and do it. But see, to me, the whole question is wrong. Why would you even want to ask, is it okay to or not? Because I'm a firm believer in that if you follow the Spirit of God, right, your desire will be for your wife. So my question to that person was, why would you want to? It's not that you should or not should not, whether you know what is right or wrong, but why would you want to? Right? In fact, what I said to him was, well, I could tell you that adultery is against God and you should not do it. And you know what? Every single Christian in the world would say God is against adultery. I mean, it's one of the Ten Commandments. Well, does that stop people from committing adultery? Does it? Of course not. Of course not. So the whole relationship has changed. We are no longer living by the sin and law and of the flesh. We have been adopted into the kingdom of God. We've been adopted as sons of God. We're born of God, where we could call out to God, not as a slave, not in the bondage of slavery, but as children of God who call him Abba Father. There's a difference. We're no longer born of God. We're no longer born of women. Right? That's the difference. So the whole idea of sin and all that kind of stuff is gone. What is interesting though, and I bet you you probably never heard this verse before. 1 John chapter 3. Listen to what it says, right? Everyone who is remaining in him does not sin. Does not sin. Everyone who is sinning has not seen him nor known him. So if you go around saying, I'm a sinner, I sin all the time, you don't know Jesus Christ. You don't know that you have been adopted into his kingdom, into his family. Then he goes on to say this, everyone who has been begotten of God, everyone who has been born of God, sin he does not. Okay? Why? Because we're not born of women anymore. Because his seed, God's seed, in him does remain. Because Christ remains in us. Thus, it says, he is not able to sin. He's not able to sin, it says in Scripture. This is 1 John chapter 3, verse 9. Because of God, he has been begotten. We are born of God. And so, in my opinion, if you continue to go by law, if you go by obeying certain kind of rules, and you go to church and they tell you there are certain things you gotta do and certain things you cannot do, then you have not really been adopted into God's family. You have not really died to sin. You're still hanging on to your earthly mother. You're born of women. No. What the Bible says is that we're born of God, right? If God dwells in you, all you gotta do is understand it. May God come alive in you, adopt you into his own family. Understand that so that we could call God Abba Father. Right? So when we could look at ourselves and say, I find no sin, what I find is God's Spirit. I will walk in that path of righteousness, the righteousness that God shows me through His Spirit each and every day. And I can't tell you what that path looks like. That's because that's between you and the Spirit of God. But I know that if you follow Him, all things will work out for good, where all things in heaven and earth will come together in Him. But in order for that to happen, in my opinion, you gotta first believe. Please believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Not in the way that so many churches will tell you about following rules, but let's get adopted into His family, right? That's the significance of calling God Abba Father. God bless you. If you enjoyed this video, please like this video and share to as many friends as you can. Let them know what the scripture really says, right? And join me next time. God bless you. See you.